Commercial jets were immediately grounded. Volcanic ash has a terrifying reputation for destroying jet engines. The most infamous case was in June 1982. BA Flight 9 was traveling from Indonesia to New Zealand when it ran straight into a cloud of volcanic ash. At first, the crew were enchanted by the dancing colors of the St. Elmo's fire effect caused by the charged ash particles. But events soon took a terrifying turn.
There was nothing on the radar whatsoever. And then the flight engineer said, number four engine's failed. So I called for that to be shut down. The flight engineer wasn't finished, though. He then said, number two's gone, number three's gone, and we've lost the lot. So there we were, up at 37,000 feet, out over the southeastern Indian Ocean, with the world's largest and heaviest glider.
Captain Moody's only hope was to descend to cleaner air, where he might be able to restart the engines. After plunging 20,000 feet, with the plane still hurtling towards the ocean, he began pumping fuel back into the system.
Where it wasn't igniting in the engines, it was coming out the back of the tail cone and igniting in the atmosphere. So it looked as though we had four engines on fire with the flames coming out the back. If you were down the back of the aircraft, you certainly knew that that wasn't normal.
The lives of more than 260 passengers and crew hung in the balance. After 50 failed attempts, finally an engine started. Then, just minutes away from impact, the other three engines sputtered into life. Captain Moody and his crew steered the plane towards Jakarta Airport for an emergency landing.
And about 100 feet over the end of the runway, I slid back in the seat and said, right, that's it, lads, we're safe and sound now. And the aeroplane, as good as gold, kissed the earth. It was wonderful.
Alaska is another danger zone for volcanic ash. The state has 52 active volcanoes and is crossed by hundreds of flights. In 1989, the volcano Redoubt, just 100 miles from Anchorage, blew its top.
We had five well-documented incidences of aircraft that encountered the ash from Redoubt and were severely damaged. The worst incident was a incoming KLM 747. They encountered an ash cloud from Redoubt. This eventually stopped or caused failure of all four of their engines. The aircraft at that point glided down for quite a long period before they were able to start two of the engines again at about 13,000 feet.
Eventually, they managed to restart all engines in time for an emergency landing in Anchorage. These near disasters are the starkest evidence of how vulnerable aircraft engines are to volcanic ash. A jet engine works by sucking in clean air and compressing it. Then, in a combustion chamber, the air is heated to around 1500 degrees Celsius. The hot gases drive a set of turbines before they are ejected at the rear of the engine, pushing the plane forward.
When these engines are flying through a volcanic dust cloud, the problem arises not because it's ash or dust, because if this went through the compressor or even the turbine, it would do very little damage. What happens is that this ash inside the combustion chamber melts. Now we've got effectively molten glass, and when it impacts the turbine blade, this melted ash deposits, and it's like creating a sort of blockage.
The buildup of molten glass chokes the flow of the hot gas through the turbine. The compressor becomes overloaded and the engine stalls. This is one of the turbine blades from BA-9's 1982 flight. It shows the buildup of the glassy deposit, which partially blocked the airflow and caused the engine to cut out. Faced with this terrifying possibility, aviation policy was to avoid volcanic ash at all costs. But the Icelandic volcano changed the rules. With economic chaos threatening to spread across the world, aviation experts were forced to reevaluate the risks. engine manufacturers and airlines conducted a range of tests in the air and on the ground. In coordination with aviation authorities, they came up with a safe level of ash. Any cloud containing less than 2 milligrams of particles per cubic meter would not cause significant damage to turbine blades. Nearly a week after its first eruption, the Icelandic volcano was still simmering, but the ash cloud had thinned to below the new safe level. The skies were finally opened.
The previous rules were avoid, avoid, avoid. Any ash, keep away. Of course, we've learned a lot from this situation here, and now the level of ash which causes difficulty in engines has been much better defined.
Air travel across the world slowly returned to normal. But it's not clear if the crisis is over. Iceland's history tells us that another eruption could be just around the corner. And future eruptions could do more than ground our aircraft. They could threaten our way of life. Iceland's volcanic eruption in April 2010 pumped enormous clouds of ash into the sky, causing havoc to international air travel. But the volcanoes of Iceland can pose far greater threats to the world. Previous eruptions from this tiny island have been responsible for the deaths of untold thousands of people across the planet. Icelanders have always been the first to suffer, as every new eruption re-sculpts their island's fragile landscape. The eruption of Eyjafjallajökull caused huge quantities of meltwater from the overhead glacier to scour the valleys below.
All the water will flood out the side of the volcano and down the side of the mountain. And these are huge floods. These floods in Iceland have Mississippi-scale flows and, in extreme cases, Amazon-scale flows.
Geologist Nick Petford arrives at the foot of the active volcano just as a new pulse of floodwater cascades off the mountain.
So if you look behind me now, you can see something absolutely spectacular. A new rush of floodwater has come down from the volcano, so clearly activity is increasing, and it's starting to melt more ice. Not all of it's gone. And if we were stood here when the eruption was taking place in full flood, all this area would have been full of that material, flooding down towards the sea, bringing great big blocks, ice the size of houses. It's really quite spectacular.
Further down the valley, broken roads and huge blocks of ice scattered across the ground are graphic evidence that the floods in the first days of the eruption ripped apart this landscape.
2 or 3 days ago, this whole area, we would be underwater now. And in fact, it would have been washed away in seconds. I mean, the torrential force of the water coming down from the volcano as it melts is immense. It might take 2 or 3 hours for the water to get down from the mountains to the sea. But in that short amount of time, the devastation is catastrophic.
Floods are one thing. Burning hot lava is another. In 1973, 5,000 residents of a small fishing village on the island of Heima Ey off the south coast of Iceland awoke to find a volcano erupting just half a mile from their homes. When the lava flow threatened to seal off the natural harbor, the townspeople banded together to redirect the flow with millions of gallons of seawater. Against all the odds, it worked.
The harbor is now sheltered by the new lava instead of being filled by it, and the harbor is still there. In fact, it's a much better harbor than it was before the eruption.
But no Icelanders are foolish enough to live close to the most active parts of the island. 40 miles north of Heima Ey lies Hekla. In the Middle Ages, it was known as the gateway to hell. It's a 3.5 mile long fissure that's erupted more than 20 times in the last 1,000 years. Most recently in the year 2000. But Hekla is nothing compared to the largest Icelandic eruption on record. This line of craters and lava flows is the site of the infamous Laki eruptions. In 1783, this was the source of the most destructive volcanic eruption in modern history, wreaking death and destruction across the world. In June of that year, a 16-mile-long fissure ripped Iceland apart. Lava poured out of 130 craters. Eyewitnesses estimated that lava fountains soared more than 4,000 feet high as billions of tons of lava erupted over an 8-month period. But it wasn't lava that made the Laki eruption so dangerous. It was the enormous clouds of ash and gas. The fissure disgorged 120 million tons.